Browns are making a triumphant return to the playoffs after a seven-year absence. Sipe was the NFL's top-rated quarterback, completing at least 50 passes to four different men. Defensively, what Cleveland lacks in consistency, they make up in intimidation. Hitters who force turnovers. Forcing turnovers in Oakland's strong point, the Raiders led the NFL in interceptions. Last week made life miserable for the Oilers. A wild card entry, they continue to be led by Jim Plunkett. He's the arm and Kenny King the offensive legs of a team that's won 10 of its last 12. We'll look at how the Raiders and Browns match up. Plus, we'll have a comical cut on the cardiac kids of Cleveland. A flip and flick about the heart-pounding heroics of a quick quarterback from the West and an upfront emotional coach from Brooklyn. That, plus highlights of yesterday's playoffs and a commentary from Newsweek's Pete Axthelm as we prepare for a playoff in the bitter cold of Cleveland, today on NFL 80. Sports presents NFL 80, an inside look at professional football and a preview of today's playoff game. Good afternoon and welcome to NFL 80. I'm Bryant Gumbel. This is Sunday number 18 of the NFL season, Sunday number 2 of Pete Rozelle's second season. We've got a very good playoff game on tap. It matches the AFC Central champion Cleveland Browns going against the Oakland Raiders, and the star may well be the weather. It's evoking memories of the 67 game played in the cold of Green Bay between the Cowboys and the Packers. But we'll get to that in a moment. Let's talk yesterday's events. Two playoff games played yesterday in San Diego. The Chargers beat the Bills 20-14, and in Philadelphia, the Eagles turned back the Vikings, the final count 31-16. A crowd of over 68,000 on hand at Veterans Stadium saw the Eagles fall behind 14-0. It was 16-14 Minnesota in the second half when Max Runiger punted the ball away to Eddie Payton. Here was the turnover that changed the game. Payton lost the handle. Reggie Wilkes came up with the ball. Philadelphia's offense was in business, and when they took the lead on a Wilbert Montgomery touchdown, they took it for good. This score made it 21-16. They put 10 more for icing on the cake. Dick Vermeil took the ride. His team will go on to play the winner of today's affair between Dallas and Atlanta. Meanwhile, out west, Chuck Knox came in with the AFC Eastern champions and saw his team play a very strong ball game in defeat. The first score set up on a pass interference call that went against San Diego's Ray Preston. He copped a plea, but it hardly mattered. Buffalo marched it on down, then Roosevelt Leach completed the drive, give Buffalo a lead of 7-3. Joe Ferguson was hurt early on in the ball game. He had no mobility, but limping around, he completed one as the first half ended to Frank Lewis, and Buffalo led 14-3. But San Diego came back. They came roaring out early in the second half. Fouts up top to Charlie Joyner. That closed it to 14-10. It was close to 14-13 with just over 2 minutes left when Fouts fired a strike into the arms of Ron Smith to move San Diego into position to meet the winner of today's game between Oakland and Cleveland. As pertains to that game, Oakland, the wild card entry, Cleveland, champions of the AFC Central. A lot of stars on both sides, but the central theme in today's game could well be the weather. Let's go out and check on the conditions with Don Brody. Don Cricky and John Brody.
Thank you, Brian. The weather is a fearsome presence here in Cleveland. This was the scene yesterday. A tarpaulin covered the playing field. It came off today, but when it did, it was a frozen playing surface. This is no day at the beach in Cleveland. It's going to be tough here. John Brody, in your many years as a quarterback in the National Football League, I know you saw some plenty of tough days. Anything like this?
I don't think the number up on the thermometer is the indicator. I played when it was 0 degrees, but there's a 35-mile-an-hour wind chill factor. I've never been in situations like this. Those players are going to have to change a lot of what they do structurally. Patterns will change. A lot of things will develop.
Well, they came out trying different shoes. They tried a soft-soled shoe they got from Canada. They used that in the Canadian Football League. A lot of them didn't like that. We're going to see how it's going to work out very shortly. Now let's go down to Mike Adamley on the field.
Well, Don and John, Cleveland's cardiac kids seem to be this year's Destiny's Children as they thrill the fans here with their improbable play. The Raiders, on the other hand, well, it was supposed to be a rebuilding year, yet they're in the playoffs, and they traded quality players for future draft choices. For a matchup of today's game, let's take a look at how the Raiders and Browns match up. Perhaps playing their last game in Alameda County Stadium in what was Bum Phillips' last game as Oiler head coach, the Raiders sacked Kenny Stabler seven times in a 27-7 wild card win. Al Davis loved what he saw as his Pride and Poise gang shut down the vaunted two tight end offense. Quarterback Lester Hayes, number 37, had a day that he can tell his grandchildren about. Two sacks and two interceptions. This one a 20-yard touchdown return which sealed the victory. Quarterback Jim Plunkett completed only eight passes on the afternoon, but two of them were for touchdowns. This one-yard strike to Todd Christensen. And then this 44-yard salvo to whip it Arthur Whittington. When all was said and done, the Raiders left the Oilers dejected. Said so long, Houston, and hello, Cleveland.
Well, one of the things we have to do is stop Sipe. He's had a tremendous year. He's completed 60% of his passes, throwing well over 500 passes. They have outstanding receivers, and we just have to do a good job in containing him because he is an elusive quarterback and gets rid of the ball quickly and can scramble. It's a different type quarterback than the one we just faced last Sunday.
We have to do a lot of things to beat the Browns. You know, on offense, they have an excellent passing attack in Brian Sipe, and they have a great core of wide receivers, and they have an excellent defense. I think what the Raiders have to do is go out and play Raider football and out-hit them and be very smart about the game and just play with a lot of intensity.
To stop Brian Sipe, we need to find a 7-foot-1 basketball-type player with the big bombs that he's throwing that I've seen on films. I think that's the only way that we can defense him.
How do I rate the Cleveland offense is the question. It's an excellent offense, a lot of weapons. Sipe is a great passer. He can run well. Mike Prout's a powerful back. They've got four receivers with over 50 receptions. We got our hands full. And the Cleveland fans are just absolutely the greatest fans in the country. And 80,000 of them packed in that stadium. Forget it. It's going to be an explosion.
Well, Tooze, you got that right. The Cleveland fans have waited 8 years for a playoff-caliber team. Now they've got Cypher Bowl fever, and why not? In Brian Sipe, the Brownies have one of the NFL's great overachievers. On the season, 30 touchdowns, over 4,000 yards passing. Not bad for a guy scouts consider too small and too unorthodox to play in the NFL. Brian was at his best when the chips were down. He had a stable of capable wide receivers to go to, like the reliable Reggie Rucker, number 33. Or the angular, number 85, Dave Logan. Or the ageless wonder, number 35, Calvin Hill. On the ground, Greg Pruitt teamed up with 1,000-yard back Mike Pruitt to keep defenses honest. As did 1979 Heisman Trophy winner Charles White. The Browns play spirited defense, and although they gave up a lot of yardage in 1980, Cleveland defenders came up with enough big plays to reach today's playoffs.
I think it's going to be a tough game. I hope it's high scoring on our part and low scoring on their part.
Well, they played an entirely different team than the Cleveland Browns last week. Of course, we don't use the two tight end offense, and in order for them to blitz cornerbacks, they've got to bring them practically from the bench, so that's something that shouldn't be a part of this game. We pick up the blitz very well, and I think that I don't have to remind people that when a defense blitzes, they're handicapping themselves. They're putting themselves in a tough spot unless they get to the quarterback. But we've got an awfully good offensive line, and we pick up those blitzes, and there's going to be some people running loose in the secondary.
I describe Oakland's defensive back as like a mugging in Central Park on weekends in New York City, if you know what I mean. They're all over you. I think their assignments are to follow the man anywhere he goes, and that's probably including if he goes into the John, they probably want you to follow him there too. They're very good, in essence, they're very good.
There's an adage that speed kills, and it does. So in order to stop a guy with the speed of Cliff Branch, you got to beat him up. Hopefully we can get to him early enough so that he doesn't catch a big play on us.
Very brutal, intimidating, talkative game. Archell, I want you. Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you, Brian, Alzado's best weapon against Art Shell won't be boxing gloves. It might be ice skates.
Michael, it's an obvious fact the conditions are the same for both sides. But based on their style of play, do the conditions figure to hurt one team more than the other? If so, which team?
Not at all, Brian. I don't think it's going to benefit either team because the field is absolutely abysmal. And as far as the fans go, well, I don't think there's going to be many no-shows here. And that could benefit the Browns because there's going to be about 80,000 plus, and it's been a big help all year long.
Okay, Mike, we'll check in later. Get in out of the cold. We've got a good ball game on tap, a pair of 11-5 teams. Oakland Raiders, the wild card entry. Cleveland Browns, champions of the Central. We'll look at their cardiac season right after this. Nothing has come easy. 12 of their 16 games have been settled by 7 points or less. So our friends at NFL Films have worked up this salute to a season the Browns won't soon forget. Thank you. back memories of the greatest Brown of them all. His name was Jim, the subject of our kickoff report.
Old Spice presents Kickoff. Kickoff is brought to you by Old Spice Aftershave Lotion, the fresh, clean scent women love.
In a game played by an always changing cast of highly competitive men, it was almost unthinkable the way Jimmy Brown totally dominated the position of fullback for almost a decade. Drafted number one out of Syracuse by the Cleveland Browns in 1957, he immediately led the league in rushing, as he would for eight of the 9 years he played. He ran like no one else ever had, with a deceptive, seemingly effortless gliding motion, a thrust that propelled him through the line and into the open field. He had different speeds, different paces, gears he could shift at will, and gang tackling was the only sure way to stop him. Incredibly, he averaged 104 yards a game over his entire career, rewriting the record book along the way. He was always different, always the same, a blend of all the essentials: straightaway power, speed, balance, boldness, strength, stamina, and courage. He never missed a game. Two simple statistics tell it all. In the history of professional football, no one has ever carried the ball for more yardage or scored more touchdowns than Jimmy Brown, Cleveland's perfect fullback.
Who's 4-0 in bonus picks? How do you introduce a man who had a push yesterday? I never could answer that. So simply, here's Pete Axton.
Thank you, Bryant. Now that we've had a look at the Cleveland Browns, I want to talk a little about the Oakland Raiders. A lot of people say that Jim Plunkett had a bad day last week, completed 8 passes. I maintain that in Al Davis's conception of football, that's not a bad day. Al has gone back to the days of Daryl LaMonica, the Mad Bomber. He doesn't want a guy to complete 18 out of 21 with the longest one for 12 yards. He wants the constant threat of the deep bomb. And he's got it now with Plunkett. He's got, as he puts it, he doesn't want respect, he wants fear. And he's got fear in the hearts of the opposition. I'd like the Raiders even better today if I knew that Al could get into the Cleveland Stadium and water the field like he does at home. But if he watered it in Cleveland, it wouldn't matter anyway because it would freeze immediately. Nevertheless, I give the Raiders a big shot today. They're one of my two bonus picks. I like the Raiders +3.5 against the Browns, and I like Atlanta -2.5 against Dallas. That brings up the question, what if the Raiders go all the way? And in the locker room, after the Super Bowl, Pete Rozelle has to hand the winning trophy to Al Davis, who has criticized him, made charges against him, and so forth. Well, I think the answer is, when Rozelle hands that trophy toward Al, Lester Hayes will intercept it.
Lester Hayes just might. He's coming off a big week. Last week against Houston, Lester Hayes, 2 sacks and 2 interceptions. And how cold is it in Cleveland? Well, you've heard of bands warming up, right? Well, when the band in Cleveland warms up, the band in Cleveland warms up. By jumping up and down, it is bitter cold, and that's what the Raiders and Browns have to face. Big ball game on tap. We'll be back with you at halftime with highlights. But right now, we're getting set for the kickoff. NFL 80 continues. We go down on the field right after these messages from your local station.
The Cleveland Browns got here with a great offense behind quarterback Ryan Sipes passing. He threw for 30 touchdowns this year, had one of the great seasons of any quarterback in National Football League history. The Raiders, an interesting contrast. It's been a great defense that's carried them to this AFC divisional playoff game. Last week against Houston, the great Lester Hayes picked off two, took this one back for a touchdown. Browns got here with offense, the Raiders with defense. And the weather is the 12th man in this game today at Cleveland. Temperature at game time, 0. Wind chill this morning, 37 degrees below 0. So the weather is a tremendous and awesome presence that is very definitely going to affect play. Good afternoon, everyone, from Cleveland Stadium. I'm Don Cricky with John Brody. John, the Raiders with their defense, the Browns with their offense. But really, when you look back at the outset of the season, it's surprising now how well they did. A lot of people were picking them third in their respective divisions.
Don, I think the reason they're both here is that they both showed that they were contenders, number one, but that they played well in the latter half of the season. Jim Plunkett, first for Oakland, came on and got them all started. Their defense picked it up after he got the momentum rolling. On the other side of the coin, Brian Sipe had one of the great years that's ever been in the National Football League. Statistics only tell a small part of that. So for both these teams to be here when they were picked to be mediocre and last is an accomplishment in itself.
Interesting attitudes on the two teams. They're both very loose clubs. Brian Sipe, the Cleveland quarterback, says everybody talks about him being a loose player under pressure. He said, Our whole team is a loose team under pressure. We've got guys, they all want the ball when the game's on the line, and the Raiders are always loose. These Pirates come in here ready to take on anybody, anytime, in any conditions.
Well, they're going to be a little puckered, I'll tell you, when they come out here. I don't care how loose they were in the locker room, which they were. Their style of personality has not changed. The people have changed greatly. I think the team that keeps their composure and does the things under awful conditions that nobody expects them to do will come out on top, and I don't know who that'll be.
Well, this is the coldest game, coldest playoff game since that famous Dallas-Green Bay game back in 67. It is really something, but a huge crowd is here, and we're just about set to go with the Raiders and the Cleveland Browns.
It is Don Ohlmeyer. Today's show produced by David Stern, directed by Bob Levy and Ken Fouts. Technical directors Sal Negita, Bruce Berquist. Associate directors Mary Buda, John Filippelli. Associate producer David Neal. Coming up, it's the Oakland Raiders and the Cleveland Browns on NBC.
Presents the best of the National Football League, the American Football Conference Divisional Playoff. Today, from Cleveland Stadium, it's the Oakland Raiders versus the Cleveland Browns. This 19... This is it, big game day on NBC. The Cleveland Browns and the Oakland Raiders. The Raiders coming in having already won the AFC wildcard game. They come in with a record now this season of 12-5. The Cleveland Browns, champions of the tough AFC Central, 11-5. The Browns called by their owner Art Modell a team of overachievers under Sam Ratigliano. You very seldom, John, hear any player speak as glowingly about a head coach as do the Cleveland Browns of Sam Ratigliano.
Well, Don, I think he has turned it around so convincingly in such a short period of time. He's the sort of fellow that the bigger the game, the more enthusiastic he is and the more he gets you ready to play it. I don't think he's one of those who concerns himself with worrying about the outcome so much as preparing his group for the game itself. And I'd say on the other side of the coin, Tom Flores does the same thing, and the personality of the two teams is such, I think it's a good indication of why they're here.
Well, Flores has done a great job, too. You don't hear enough about Tom Flores in his second year as the head coach of the Raiders, but in all those great seasons, the Oakland Raiders have had 16 consecutive winning seasons. No team in the National Football League has done that in the history of the league. Flores has been the offensive coordinator. He's planned all the game plans over the years, the recent years, and now he's the head man. The Raiders are ready, you can be sure, and so are the Browns. Wind chill, minus 30 some odd degrees, 37 at the outset. The up back takes the kickoff. Doesn't get too far with it. Todd Christensen got the ball. Got across the 30-yard line to about the 31. So Jimmy Plunkett now comes out to quarterback the Raiders with Kenny King and Mark Van Egan. He'll be a big factor in this game, the runners. Cliff Branch and Bob Chandler, the wide receivers. Raymond Chester, the tight end. The great offensive line of the Raiders. Art Shell and Gene Upshaw on the left side. Dave Dolby at center. Nicky Marvin and Henry Lawrence on the right side. The Raiders set to go. First play from scrimmage, and they are starting up early in Cleveland. An unbelievable following of the Cleveland Browns. It's rejuvenated the city, picked up the whole community. The Browns are the heroes of Cleveland, and right now the Brown defense doesn't give much up, nor does the playing field, which is rock hard. As the Raiders go to Mark Van Egan, and he got ahead for maybe a yard. Clearly they have it spotted. He got to about the line of scrimmage. Cleveland young on the defensive line except for Alzado. Marshall Harris and Henry Bradley, the nose tackle, along with Alzado. Good linebackers in Charlie Hall, Robert L. Jackson, Dick Ambrose, and Clay Matthews. Bolton had a great year at the left corner. Burrell's a young player at LSU. They like him a lot. Darden and Scott, the safeties, experience been good. Second down and over nine. Plunkett stands in, lets it go long, and Jim Plunkett wasn't anywhere close to his intended receiver. He was looking at Kenny King coming out of the backfield.
Don, I think you're going to see an awful lot of things change throughout the course of the game as the players realize how good their footing is, or on the other side of the coin, how poor it is. The type of patterns you're going to see run are the type that don't take a lot of movement, not a lot of pattern running, anything where a guy gets going in one direction, across the flow, keep the defensive backs making their movements as sharply as possible, because you're not going to have any footing. That's all there is to it.
They had the field covered, but when it came off, the wind whipped down and killed it into a rock-hard playing surface. On third down and nine, Plunkett takes a deep look, goes way over Chandler, and as the ball came overhead, Ron Bolton put a slug on Bobby Chandler. Al Davis told us early, John, that he got Bob Chandler for one big reason. He's a cold weather player from his years at Buffalo. He catches it in cold weather, but not one like this. It's too high.
He's one of the few fellas, I think, who will run his patterns better than most players will. They're going to double on Branch. They don't want to let him loose. It's going to be very hard executing all day long. You're going to see Bob Chandler in a position to catch a lot of balls. It's getting the execution done that'll be the tough part. On the other side of the coin, Cleveland's got their work cut out for them, too, because they got to this playoff because they put the ball up in the air. And the conditions today do not indicate that.
Well, now we're going to have a punt from the Oakland Raiders, Ray Guy. Snap's good. He gets off a punt, doesn't carry too deep. It's going to be taken by Keith Wright. Crosses the 30. He's caught. Ball is blown dead at the 30-yard line. There's going to be some turnovers. You can count on that. Ray Guy with that absolutely unbelievable punting day against Houston in the wild card game, and he kicked 9 for an average of over 51 yards, kicked that one 44. Brian Sipe, the number one quarterback this season in the NFL at quarterback. Mike Pruitt, a big back from Purdue, and Calvin Hill, the veteran, will be the starting runners for the Browns. Dave Logan, Richie Rucker, and Ozzie Newsome, all with over 50 receptions, the receivers. Good offensive line. They don't let Sipe get hurt very often. Deacon, Shepard, DeLeon, DeLamalier, and Cody Risen. Cleveland with its first possession. First down and 10 for the Browns at their 30. Sipe goes right after the deep throw, and he's going to Logan. Screened off the ball by Dwayne Osteen. So the Browns come out pitching. As you were pointing out, John, they got here throwing the ball, and Sipe's ready to go despite the weather.
I don't think there's going to be any change of the way they attack, whether or not they throw the ball a lot. They will throw the ball an awful lot because Oakland would love to have a team running the ball on first and 10, because guys like Matusa, Kinlaw, you name it, those down linemen have been very strong against the run all year. They've shut teams down to 40 yards a game less than they did last year.
There's the defensive secondary. The Raiders have intercepted more than any team in the NFL. They have 35 interceptions as a team. On second and 10, Calvin Hill gets the call, and the big back from Yale takes it straight ahead to the 35-yard line, a gain of 4 yards on the play. It'll be second down at 6. Dave Browning made the knockdown, defensive right end. Matuzak, Kinlaw, and Browning across the defensive front of Oakland.
Don, the offensive line of Cleveland has three players going to the Pro Bowl. They match up very well against Oakland's defensive front four. And if you don't handle them at the line of scrimmage, they will dictate the outcome of a football game, as they did last week against Houston.
Third down and about 5 for Cleveland. Ball just across their 35-yard line. There's no score early in the first quarter. Sipe stands in, sets up, gets time, puts it out there, and a free ball is in the secondary, incomplete. Came into Calvin Hill, and that ball was skirt free in the secondary.
Don, you'll notice Calvin Hill was a ball carrier on the second play of the game, an intended pass receiver on third down. They've started him today for the first time all year for two reasons. One, so he can protect Brian Sipe. Number two, so he can run pass routes. He'll carry the ball a little bit, but he's in there because this is going to be a day, in their opinion, they want the experience. They want the guy that is not going to let someone free on Brian Sipe.
Now back to receive the punt, Keith Moody for the Oakland Raiders. Johnny Evans into punt for the Browns, hits the ball at his 25, looks like somebody got a piece of it. It goes downfield, takes a Cleveland roll low, and a hop out inside the 30-yard line, roll down to the 28. And there, the Raiders will go on offense for a second time in this playoff game. Johnny Evans, a 39-yard per punt man throughout this season for Cleveland. Sam Ratigliano was particularly concerned about Evans' counterpart, Ray Guy, and his kicking game. We'll be back at Cleveland in a moment. With John Brody, this is Don Cricky back at Cleveland Stadium. The sun is out, but the wind chill has the temperature on the playing field at minus 30 degrees. The Oakland Raiders have the ball for the second time. First and 10. Plunkett hands off, goes to Van Egan. And Van Egan, one of the quickest fullbacks in the league at hitting the hole, as offensive linemen will tell you. has a hard time driving ahead on a frozen playing surface. Marshall Harris, the left end for the Browns, knocked him down. So the Raiders come up with second and nine.
Anybody that's quick hitting the line today is going to get a check. Okay. I don't think that anyone's going to be too quick. Getting off, just getting off in the snap of the ball, making sure your footing's okay, will give you a chance to take advantage of someone else who might fall, and that's what's going to dictate the breaks.
Second and over nine. Bob Taylor comes fly to the right. Cliff Branch to the left. Swing pass goes to Kenny King. And King of the Raiders loses the ball as he goes out of bounds. Along either sideline, it is sheer, hard-packed ice where the tarp wasn't covering, and there's portions of the playing field that have some ice on it. Froze up once the tarp came off. It is a tough track.
You'll notice Cleveland is going to make Jim Plunkett throw it off to his backs. It's something he doesn't do very often. When he does, they are very effective. He's just not geared to be one of those nickel and dime type quarterbacks. They try to attack a defense. Cleveland's not going to allow him to do that. You'll see them in no man-to-man situations early. He's got to come off to his backs and hope something good happens.
Arthur Whittington is now in the backfield of Oakland, along with Van Egan. Third down and five for the Raiders. Plunkett lets her go long. Chandler going for the ball. It's intercepted by Cleveland's Ron Bolton. He was their leading interceptor this year. That was his seventh, so the Browns get the first turnover. Although Chandler fought him for the ball all the way down, but Ron Bolton gets the interception. And watch it again, John.
I'll tell you, Don, that was as good as a punt. Very few people can punt the ball that far as Jim just threw it. Obviously, it's always fun to intercept the ball. You gear yourself down as a defensive secondary player to pick up anything that comes in your area. Ron Bolton, on that particular occasion, was 15 yards back of the line of scrimmage.
Here is Ron Bolton's interception, and the Browns have their second possession. They'll start from their 27-yard line.
Again, it was an attempt to attack a defensive man playing one-on-one with Bob Chandler. You have to try that, but it was a hook and go. Bolton was buying none of it, way beyond Chandler when the ball was in the air.
Ron Bolton, the only guy that's caught a ball so far today. Here's the handoff on the first down from scrimmage, and driving straight ahead is the big Purdue fullback, Mike Pruitt. Over 1,000 yards rushing again this year. 4.2 a carry. And he was best leading receiver for Cleveland, 63 receptions.
And that still misses his most important ingredient, his ability to get all the assignments correct, the ability to block for Brian Sipe. That's how he originally got into the starting lineup, as a blocker for Greg Pruitt. He came on so well, ran the ball so well, that he's become a mainstay.
Brian Sutton, Mike Pruitt, both really developed as football players when Sam Ratigliano came in here. They've been the keys on offense. Here's a handoff. Again, they go to Pruitt on a second down and six carry. Pruitt takes the ball out to the 34-yard line. John, we were talking about how nobody was looking for these teams at the outset of the season to make the playoffs. And even when the season began, it didn't look that way. They both lost three of their first five.
That's right. However, the whole personality of Oakland changed at midseason. Their defense, you know, it's a very young defense. And contrary to what a lot of people think of, in the transition that's taken place in Oakland, a lot of the insurgence of new players has been defensively, and they have played so well. The guys like Lester Hayes, Matt Millen, a fellow that they thought was in between a linebacker and a defensive lineman, he's come on, they've let him do what he does best, and they've just come up with an amazing defense.
Now it's third down and about three for the Cleveland Browns. No score in the first quarter. They go to Pruitt. Raiders don't get much. He had to drive the ball out to the 40, to the 37-yard line, and we'll see if he got there as they unpile. John, what about the football in playing conditions like this? Is it hard enough?
They could play without it. I mean, it's very hard to hang on to, obviously. Now, it's like a brick in certain conditions, and they will try to throw the ball around because Cleveland has to do that. They've got a first down. Excellent offensive line search got them that. Right now, when Sipe can throw a little screen, if he can run some draws, anything that's misdirection. Don't make anybody change their own direction, but get the defense to change theirs. Sipe is a master at dinking and donking the ball around the infield, and if there's an edge, he might have it.
That was our first down of the game. Ryan Sipe sets down the Cleveland Browns at their 37. No score in the first quarter. Sipe sets up. Looking long, guns it over the middle, and Dave Logan had the ball and lost it. Now, Logan's one of the most sure-handed players in the league. You saw he was unable to take it.
Don, you can't catch the ball in your hands. The ball is too hard. It feels like a frozen puck to any wide receiver at this time. If they can catch the ball in their body, they're okay. Now, this fella, his whole personality is to catch the ball in his hands. Rather than put his hands out after the ball, he's got gloves on, he's trying to make sure he can cradle the ball. It hits him in the stomach, coming a little harder than he hoped. They have to re-huddle.
Second down and 10. Brian Seif comes into this game completing over 61% of his throws for over 4,100 yards, 30 touchdown throws. And he was only intercepted 14 times. He graded out as the number one quarterback in the league. And he'll start for the AFC in the Pro Bowl. Hand off with Mike Pruitt. Coming out of his three-point, lost his footing, goes down to the 36-yard line. He'll be third and about 12.
Reggie Kinlaw, a fellow from Oklahoma. Here's another young standout defensive lineman for the Raiders. He's taking that middle, handling it very well. Now, in order for anybody to do well, if you're a Cleveland offensive football player, you know you've got to handle the middle. It's Dalby's problem on when the Raiders are on offense. It's DeLeon's problem when the Browns are on offense.
Ed Hendricks, Matt Millen, Bob Nelson, Rod Martin, the linebackers for the Raiders. Actually, two of the linebackers, Hendricks and Millen, are biggest defensive linemen. Seif on third and 12 swings it out. Calvin Hill makes the turn, but Millen catches him, the rookie from Penn State. He's the biggest linebacker in the league from a weight standpoint, 260, and is next to him is Hendricks, who's the tallest at 6'7".
Don, and the concern about Millen is that can he cover anyone on pass routes? That time in a third down situation, they left him in the ball game. He covers Calvin Hill from the middle of the field all the way to the sideline. He's in a one-on-one situation, covers him very well, forces him to the sideline, and makes the tackle.
But the Browns come up way short, and so they will go back to the punt now. Johnny Evans to hit the ball, standing at this 26-yard line. Keith Moody is back all alone at the 20-yard line of the Raiders. Good snap by Sullivan. End-over-end kick. It'll be tough to field, and it takes again a Cleveland bounce. Well, that one had legs on it. Down to the nine. Moody picks it up, but the Browns sweep him under. So the Raiders start out for a third time, but in a hole.
There's something. They're giving the punter just a little bit too much credit. It's a 50-yard punt. Should have been caught for a 30-yard stop. That's a very important phase of this game. Get up there and catch that ball before it hits the ground, because if you don't, you might find yourself first and 10 inside your own 10.
The Raiders are now, but to their own. They're backed up to their 11 after the punt. Shut down the run. Dan Egan tries to go straight ahead, and Dick Ambrose fills the gap nicely.
Ambrose filled the gap, but they're running at Lyle Alzado, something they don't really want to do. But their plus point over the years has been Art Shell and Gene Upshaw. Alzado mentioned early before the ball game that whenever I play against Shell and Upshaw, I'm not the same for 3 weeks. He said, I don't know what effect it has on them, but I do know how it handles me.
It's a war down there. Upshaw, in his 13th year, has never missed a game. He's playing in his 250th consecutive game. End off. Kenny King, and the Browns don't give him a thing. Browns have done well all season stopping the run.
We're taking a look at Dick Ambrose. Sam Bogosian said they've got some fine linebackers, but the guy that holds them all together is Ambrose. He's always in the wrong spot if you're offensively minded. He's always sitting where your ball carrier is trying to run the ball. He's been underrated for a long period of time. Maybe that's why they're so good against the run.
Ambrose has been underrated for a long time. Came out of Virginia as a 12th round draft choice back in 75, and he's been a consistent, very, very valuable player to the Cleveland defensive effort all these seasons, now in his sixth year. Plunkett on third down, seven throws. He's got a man open, and then he loses the ball. Clay Matthews was there to hit Kenny King just as it came in.
Okay, Plunkett's thrown the ball pretty well on third down occasions twice. However, it's just as hard to handle as it is to get the ball there. Doesn't seem like either team is willing to suck it up and run the ball, hoping for a turnover. They both know they've got to create something. It's a healthy viewpoint, but very tough to execute.
Well, the Browns defense holds again. It was a defense that gave up more yards than any defense in the AFC, but it didn't give up a lot of points.
Again, let's check the punt returners. They're giving Ray Guy an awful lot of credit when the ball is as cold as it is. They're both playing 40 to 45 yards from the line of scrimmage. Under normal conditions, I can understand it, but they better get somebody up a little closer to pick off the short one.
The winner of this game will, of course, be going to San Diego to play the Chargers next Sunday in the AFC Championship game here on NBC. Here is the punt. Ray Guy hits it well down the field. Dino Hall fields it back at his 40. Makes the turn to the 45, and Dino Hall, not big but very quick, takes the ball up the far sideline. And the Browns start out with their best initial field position of any of their drives, a 46-yard punt, a 7-yard return by Dino Hall. So with the wind chill in the minus 30s, we'll be returning to Cleveland Stadium after this. 1980 was the first divisional title year for the Cleveland Browns in 71. This is their first playoff team since 72 when they went as a wild card. But it's been a storied tradition. Football in Cleveland, a hallmark franchise in the NFL. The great teams, the Motley and Otto Graham teams. And this stadium has been the site of some of the great games in the history of the league. Great championship games. Now with no score on the board, Brian Sipe takes a long look. He's looking at Dave Logan. Logan had the ball and lost it. With 6:48 to play in the first quarter, the Browns try to strike deep and almost succeed.
Well, Don, you see, catching a football is just part of a movement. It's not a conscious thought to catch the football. You do that, it's automatic. All the intention is on a way to run your pattern and get open. Today, the game changes. You've got to put all your attention on catching the football. It's not so hard to get open because everybody's slipping and sliding out there. But when that ball gets in your area, to hang on to it is a problem.
A real problem. And it's not going to get any better. The Browns now come out second down and 10. First team that gets in the end zone might have won the game when this one is finally decided.
Well, I think the players are getting more accustomed to it than less, and that surprises me.
Sipe throws long again. Calvin Hill is out there. And the ball literally bounced off the helmet of Rod Martin. Calvin Hill, what a story he is. Came to Cleveland in 78 as a free agent after his great seasons with Dallas and Washington.
And we mentioned he runs about as precise a route as any back going down the pike. They got him because they knew he was a very experienced, good blocking, good receiving halfback. And when you have a guy like Brian Sipe, to have a halfback like Calvin Hill is something you just can't replace. When you catch 50 balls as a halfback, you know you've helped some.
Calvin Hill has been a great one. 6 touchdown receptions this year for the Browns. They call him the pinch hitter. He comes in and hits the home run for him, making those receptions. Third down and 10. Sipes only completed 1 of 6. Look at the interception by the great Lester Hayes. The man's a phenomenal football player. Lester Hayes with his 16th interception of this season. He had 2 last week and 13 in the regular season, and he had 4 other ones that were negated by penalties.
Don, when you see Lester Hayes, he's playing bump and run. Now, if you're a quarterback, you say, hey, he's playing bump and run all over the field. I've got to be able to get to Reggie Rucker. He's got him one-on-one all over the field. He might even fall down. Lester Hayes intimidates people. It's why he's gained 13 interceptions this year, is because teams are reluctant to let him get away with that. However, he's winning at his own game, having the greatest year of any cornerback for several years. He and Hendricks have been so outstanding, the Raiders have just gone with him.
Well, they challenged Lester Hayes, and they came up empty, and now the Raiders have the ball back. Interception each way so far in the game, and a first and 10 play. Robert L. Jackson comes in and makes the stop on Kenny King. You remember Ron Bolton had the interception earlier. Game clock down to 6:20 to play in the first quarter. No score on the board or anything close to it so far.
You see King running back to the huddle almost as hard as he ran to the line of scrimmage. I tell you, they're trying to stay warm, trying to pump themselves up, trying to convince themselves it's not cold out there, and it's a hard thing to do.
They truck some heated benches in from Philadelphia. That's only mild help, though, in these conditions. It's now second down and 7, and the Browns shut down the run. They go back to Kenny King, the Oklahoma runner, who had a 4.4 per carry average this season, knocked down by Charlie Hall.
You know what you might think looking into this ballgame? You say, boy, this really has to hurt Brian Sipe and his offense. I think it helps their defense more than it hurts Brian's offense. What is Cleveland? They're good against the run, extremely suspect against the pass. They've allowed 3,800 yards plus, but when it comes to somebody running over the top of them, nobody's had success doing it.
They stopped the long pass, and they stopped the run. Marshall Harris, no flag is down, though. He got back in time, apparently. Plunkett going long. Cliff Branch is out there. Through his arm. Branch had a step on the defender, Clinton Burrell. And the Raiders almost hit the big one.
Both these quarterbacks have fired the ball very well. When you can throw the ball accurately at 40 yards, the wind doesn't seem to be as much of a factor as it was at kickoff time. You know you can throw it. Hanging on again is a problem.
Right now, we pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC television network. With John Brody, this is Don Cricky. Mike Adamley also with us here at Cleveland Stadium for this AFC playoff game. The Oakland Raiders and the Cleveland Browns scoreless in the first quarter, 5:14 to play in it. As the Raiders punt again. Ray Guy didn't get this one downfield too far, but they're all so tough to handle, and the Browns won't challenge the ball. They'll let it roll dead, and it goes down at about the 30-yard line of Cleveland. All of America felt their heartbreak at Lake Placid, but now Ty Babalola again, this time starting out at their 30. That was only a 31-yard punt by Ray Guy.
He got a bad bounce, though. It could have gone right down inside the 10. Nobody was there to field it.
Actually hopped back toward the Raiders. Sipe on first down, looking long. Man is out there. Reggie Rucker had his fingertips on the ball. So we've had a lot of near misses in the game as both quarterbacks challenging deep. Despite playing conditions with temperatures minus 30 chill factor.
And who were they challenging? They're challenging Lester Hayes. He just comes up with an interception. The next time they get the ball, they say, let's have one more go at Lester. If he wants to get his 15th of the year, let him try. We think we can beat him. And a lot of receivers do beat Lester Hayes. It's just that he beats them on occasion, too.
Actually, Lester, John, his next one's going to be a 17th now after what he's done in the playoffs. He has three already in the playoffs. Go with his 13 in the regular season. What a year.
He's had about six drops and four called back, too.
Actually, had a 95-yard interception return for a touchdown against Miami, negated by a penalty. On second and 10, Cleveland goes to the run, and behind Alana Lear and Cody Risen, Mike Pruitt rockets ahead across the 35-yard line, got the ball close to the 37. So there's a gain on the play of about 7 yards.
It's really the best offensive running play we've seen so far today. There has just been almost no offensive movement. When you have no footing, to get a defensive lineman on your shoulder and move him backwards is a very tough thing to do.
Well, those linemen, John, knew they were in for a bad day when they came out to warm up, got down to the 3-point, took off, and fell flat in their face.
Right. The 2-point stance may come into vogue before this game's over.
Third down and 3 for Cleveland. Ryan Sipe goes to the draw. Pruitt working hard, but the Raiders seem to knock him down just short of the first down. It'll be a yard or so short, brings up fourth down, and with that down comes punter Johnny Evans. Matt Millen made the knockdown.
Mentioned draws and screens early. The problem with draws right at this time is that the linebackers are not respecting throw. If you don't respect throw, you can't get those linebackers out of the holes.
We've only had one first down in this game so far. 3:49 left to go in the first quarter.
The big phase of the game so far has been the handling of the punts, and not only by the defense, but also from center to kicker.
Keith Moody is back for the Raiders. Line drive downfield, but again it takes a Cleveland roll, and Moody won't fool with it. So Johnny Evans hit that thing about 8 feet in the air, but on the frozen turf it kept on walking and goes down inside the 30. A 34-yard punt as it ended up.
Not bad. It was net.
That's right. No return. Ryan Sipe being attending to himself on the sidelines. A lot of the players were wearing scuba diver gloves coming out. Keith Wright, one of the return men for Cleveland, was catching the ball very well before the game with him. Other ones had on those golf gloves. They came off quickly. Most of them seemed to be going to nothing of the scuba dive. Right now it's going to be first down and 10 for Oakland. Handoff goes. Kenny King breaks it. Gets across the 30 and out to the 32-yard line. So the Raiders come out with a slant run. And King does well. Clarence Scott, the strong safety, made the knockdown. Kenny King, one of those Houston Oilers who came to Oakland.
I'm waiting for some to break, Don. I know it's very difficult to move the ball. If we see Kenny King pick up a 6-yard gain, which is a pretty good first and 10. I think something's about to break. Very few defenders have fallen down, and the receivers are having all the problems at the moment. I don't think that'll last.
It's second down and 5. Raiders try to run again, and nothing's there. They've had one interception for each side. Ron Bolton picked one off for Cleveland. Lester Hayes got one for Oakland. No fumbles yet, though, but there's going to be some, you can be sure.
If there aren't, it'll be a surprise to everyone. Looks like a jump center in the middle of the line. Everybody's standing straight up. Very difficult to make movement anyway.
Bob Chandler comes out wide right now. Cliff French, who went deep and almost made a connection earlier, is wide left on a third down and 3 play. Plunkett looking at Chandler. Now throws over the middle to his tight end, and the ball is caught and lost. Raymond Chester had it at the 42-yard line and lost it. Tom Darden popped in the free safety, 27.
All right, Tom Darden hasn't had a lot of action all year because people have not tried to pick on him. Personality of Oakland is to throw the ball deep. They haven't done an awful lot of it except on the outsides all day long. They get Raymond Chester open. Plunkett finds a way to get him the ball, but any contact that's made as the ball gets there, you can't grab a handle. There's no way to keep that ball when you're hit.
No way at all. Now they put back two punt returners, Dino Hall and Keith Wright. Ray Guy set himself up at his 20. The footing's so tough. Moving into the ball just to strike it. Bounce came close to a block. Wright takes it in those scuba diver gloves. Back of the 20. And
he's got
a field. He's got a shell. Keith Wright brings it. Finally knocked down the 39-yard line. Wright had beaten that last man. He'd have gone a long, long way as it was a return to 19 yards. 1:55 left to play in the first quarter.
They get everybody caught, Don, coming straight up the middle. They just sealed off a little bit to the outside. Wright's trying to find a hole. Can't find it quite well enough. 46-yard punt, 19-yard return. Derek Jensen finally made the play.
Keith Wright had to be helped off the field after the play. You're playing on concrete out there today. 1:55 to go in the first quarter. No score on the board. The Browns, champions of the AFC Central, line up again. First and 10 at their 40. Two wide receivers set to the right. Two big backs behind Sipe, Pruitt and Calvin Hill. Sipe takes a look, throws over the middle, and Reggie Rucker makes the big play for the Cleveland Browns down to the Oakland 40.
Again, Don, we mentioned I'm expecting something to happen offensively because I'm surprised the quarterback has not had the problem holding onto the ball and delivering it that the receiver has, catching it and holding on. And when a quarterback can throw it throughout the period of the day, the receivers will find a way to get their hands on it and keep containment. Both quarterbacks have thrown the ball pretty well. Sipe is not having any problem with his grip, but if you don't have a problem with your grip and you can get back and set up, you can find the receiver.
Well, that was the biggest offensive gain of the day, a 20-yard completion. Now, the Browns go to the run, and Pruitt takes it off tackle inside the 40 down to the 38-yard line. Don Cockcroft, the kicker for Cleveland, playing in his sixth playoff year. 13-year veteran was talking about kicking conditions on a field like this. He said one thing is you don't get the long field goal. The ball doesn't travel far.
No, it won't. You'll notice on the punts, those balls are going 12 yards sometimes and starting to run. Ray Guy kicked two over 40 yards, and those are horrendous boots in this weather.
Well, we've seen so far the best way to get there to the end zone is to throw the ball because the runners haven't gotten much. Second down and 7 now. Sipe takes a look, swings it out. Ozzie Newsome, the tight end, takes the ball down at the 32-yard line, and he's very close to a first down on a 2nd-and-8 play.
We'll notice a little bit later how Brian Sipe's drop has changed a little bit. He is really oozing back into his throwing area. Footing is a little bit difficult, but the receiver can get open. You can see Rod Martin standing still. It's pretty hard for him to get any traction. Ozzie Newsome runs a quick pattern, gets the ball to him. Simple little pattern to run, easy to hit, hard to hold on.
Big Ozzie Newsome, the third-year tight end from Alabama. The man Bear Bryant called the greatest catcher we ever had at Alabama. Sipe spreads the work around. Rucker, Logan, Newsome all with over 50 catches, and Mike Pruitt had 63. Third and one, and the Browns power the ball at the Oakland Raiders. Pruitt at 6'1", 227 pounds. Drives into linebacker Bob Nelson, and the Browns drive on.
They went right over their own strength. DeLeon, Shepard, DeLamalure, those three fellas have been pretty good for quite a while. Got good surge on 3rd and 1. 7 seconds left in the quarter. I think this is the last play. They're trying to get one off.
Right on 3rd down, looking to the end zone. Rucker's out there. Touchdown, he lost the ball. Reggie Rucker had his hands on it and lost it going out of the end zone.
He almost lost himself. He went right in the dugout. Looks like Osteen's trying to help him out. Hey, we mentioned the throwers have had good grips on the ball. They put the ball where it has to be thrown if it's going to be caught. Rucker made a fine pattern, just didn't come down with the ball.
Back at cold, cold Cleveland, we're ready to start the second quarter of play. The Browns mounting a threat now. They have 2nd down and 10 inside the Raider 30-yard line. No score on the board. Brian Sipe takes a look over. On a check off. Two wide receivers set left. Raiders up and tight and ready to bump and run. On Second and 10, a throw deep. Ozzie Newsom heading for the end zone with the ball, as you see, comes in high. Strong safety Mike Davis running with him for Oakland.
Don, again, a crossing pattern. They're putting Mike Davis in an awful bind. They're leaving a free safety back there for Oakland is. But when you have to cover Ozzie Newsom all over the field, if he finds any segment of that field where he can get a little bit of footing, and the players are getting a pretty good feel of that situation now, in the middle of the field, there are places where you can plant and break away from a defensive back. That's an awful tough assignment. They've tried to come to Newsom a couple times, haven't been successful yet, but they're going to keep going at it. Two for six on third down. It's now third and 10.
At the 29. Sipe, well attended to again. Has time, throws, incomplete. Ted Hendricks was back there. Knocked down Greg Pruitt, who came into the game. Coming out of the backfield was the antenna receiver. Pruitt in for the first time. Greg Pruitt.
They threw to Greg Pruitt because on the other side, Lester Hayes did an excellent job on Logan. They wanted to go down the field, and the Raiders are playing a man-to-man most all over the field right now. They just have to get one person free. They haven't been able to do it.
Cleveland coaches said you're assessing the Raiders on film. Their defense isn't complicated. It just executes so well.
Cockcroft is going to earn his salary if he slips this one in from 47 and a half, 48 yards. Just like kicking a 55-yarder.
The inability to throw and catch the ball in this cold weather has been a story so far, and also to kick it as Cockcroft, a sure-footed kicker, drives the ball into the end zone, but it doesn't come anywhere close to going through the uprights, and so the first scoring attempt from the placement comes up way empty, and with 14:44 left to play in the first half, we'll be back to Cleveland in a moment. This is Don Quickie with John Brody back at Cleveland. The Raiders haven't made a first down in this game yet.
And there hasn't been a penalty called throughout the whole first quarter. That's a rarity.
That's right. There's not been any penalties. Plunkett on first down throws, and there's a connection. Receiver taking it right in his chest. Raymond Chester gets ahead to the 40-yard line, and the Raiders all of a sudden have their first down of the game. Robert L. Jackson on the knockdown.
Pattern, you very rarely see Raymond Chester run. It looks like he's going to go down the field and make a turn. He goes down the field and stops. He's right in between two linebackers. Just as he stopped, Plunkett got him the ball. That's why it looks like he's so wide open. It's against his characteristics. It's against the Oakland patterns. But it works. They're going to have to makeshift a few things today.
Heath Wright, the punt returner, who was knocked down hard on the playing field, we're told has a concussion and probably won't play again today. Plunkett loses the ball. That's a free football, and Cleveland has it. The Cleveland Browns have the ball inside the 25-yard line of Oakland. So the first fumble recovery of the game is a big, big one. Marshall Harris, the left end, swept up the ball as Plunkett had it knocked free, fading to throw. And the Browns will go first and 10 at the 23-yard line of Oakland.
It all took place, Don, for one simple reason. Marshall Harris was the recipient, but it took place because the defensive secondary was playing real deep. Plunkett wanted to go down the field. You can see Bradley, he comes in, gets a piece of the ball. Plunkett did not give him credit for being able to get it loose. He did jar it loose, didn't come off to a back quick enough. As a result, turnover.
Got to be tough just to hold that cold ball with everybody
swiping. Yeah, but you better get it off to your backs. If nobody's open down the field, you better do it quick.
It's first down and 10 now for the Cleveland Browns. Sipe takes a look. They're really taking care of him. He's going to run with the ball. Ryan Sipe is inside the 15-yard line. Down to the 13-yard line. Rod Martin finally got him, but now the Browns are down close.
Had the same effect as a draw play. Sipe went back trying to throw, had all his receivers running crossing routes. Sipe did not run around laterally, took whatever hole he found up the middle, just moved a little bit to his left. When he did so, there was a natural hole opened up. The linebackers cannot commit themselves to getting up on the play as fast as normal. Petusik finally gets there, gets a piece swiftly. Martin brings him down, but not before they gain a first down.
Marshall Harris with the recovery, a former New York Jet. And now Brian Sipe with a first down run. Handoff up the middle, not much there. Going with the ball is Cleo Miller, a big back. He drives the ball down close to the 13-yard line. This telecast is presented by authority of the National Football League and is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the Cleveland Browns and the National Football League is prohibited.
When they start running, Don, Bob Nelson, number 51 for the Raiders, is generally in the middle of the action. He stopped that play for no gain. He's another one of those young insertions that the Raiders have put into their defense.
Ball down to the 13-yard line now. Bob Nelson, a former Buffalo Bill. Raiders have an awful lot of people they got from other teams as free agents that have turned into fine players when they get in the whole scheme of the Oakland system. Here's a pass into the end zone. Logan fighting for the ball. Wayne Osteen fighting for it. And it comes up incomplete.
Well, that's an outstanding defensive play by Osteen, because Logan was sitting with his eye on the ball the whole time. Osteen's got his back to the ball, carries the club. He sees Logan looking at the ball. He goes right into the area he's looking, almost brings it down for an interception. That's just good defense. He's one-on-one out there all by himself.
A fight for the ball on the one-on-one coverage. Our producer today for NBC is George Finkel, our director, Ken Fouts. As we now have 12 minutes and 19 seconds left to play in the first half. The Browns challenging, but it's so tough to move the ball with frigid temperatures in Ohio. Wind chill this morning was 37 below zero. Third down and 10 for Cleveland. Sipes stands in, into the end zone. Rucker going for the ball. He caught it! No, they ruled he got it out of bounds. He held Amuth, the official right there, said he was not in bounds when he got it.
Hey, that's one of those plays that if the field had been dry, he would have been able to slow his momentum down enough to get his other foot in bounds. As it existed, he couldn't do that. He just caught the line with his second foot. The official was right on the play and saw it. But, hey, they're picking on those corners, and as long as they try to play a man-to-man, they're going to try and continue picking on them. You see Rucker comes down with one foot there. He can't put his foot down. He's got to put his other foot on the yellow.
So now Don Cockcroft will try another field goal, but first we'll watch Rucker again. This is live. Cockcroft setting up for the field goal.
No cinch.
Paul McDonald holds, and Jerry Sullivan snaps. And the ball is on the way. It is no good. Lester Hayes went to the moon when that one went wide. He jumped about 10 feet in the air.
It's one thing to throw the ball down. It's another thing to kick it. It's a totally different feel when it hits your foot. The ball goes like a brick. We've seen punts have problems. We've seen two chances for field goals have problems, and the score remains at nothing to nothing.
Don Fricke with John Brody back at frigid Cleveland. John, what about the quarterback touch in this weather?
Well, we've seen them. They've had very good control of the ball. The receivers have had no control of it. As a result, you need both ends to make things come into a good result. You see Van Egan trying to get somewhere at the line of scrimmage. They've just had trouble moving either the offensive or defensive line for the Browns around. I think the Browns are getting the best at the point of attack right now. As a result, they've had a little bit better field position, but no score has resulted. It's going to be tough.
Senior members of the National Football League, Don Cockcroft, has had his problems. He was troubled with a sciatic nerve problem earlier. Played well late in the season, and today, this cold, cold ball hasn't been responding to his ticking touch. It was nothing, nothing. They go back to the run now, and second down and nine. Kenny King goes wide, and the Cleveland Browns have been sweeping him under.
Well, they can go as wide as they want, but when you go wide, the key is being able to cut back against the grain when you see the hole. They have not been able to cut back, and when you're running wide with a lot of pursuit following you, the running back is up for grabs. All they have to do is keep everybody coming out at an angle. They'll eventually run him right out of bounds.
Brown offensive line has been moving the ball pretty well at times. Oakland has had virtually no success running it. Brown defense has been taking away the Raiders' gusto with the run. Now Plunkett's going to try to throw it. Put it way up for grabs. Clinton Burrell goes for the ball and can't hold on. Cliff Branch was downfield. Wasn't anywhere near him. Burrell had a short play on it, but it's so hard to hold on to. That thing came down like a 12-pound.
Branch got very lucky right there because he could not find the ball. Was going over to Burrell trying to defend the play and had no attention on the ball. He knew that it was a possible interception. He was just trying to break it up and didn't get a call.
Keith Wright going off suffered the mild concussion when his head was banged off the playing field on a punt return. Dino Hall is the only man back now for Cleveland as Ray Guy sets to punt. Fourth down and 12. Ray Guy back at his 5-yard line. Browns are getting people close to Ray Guy, and now they drop two more back. High punt, didn't carry very far. Dino Hall from his 46. Dino Hall breaks through and gets out to midfield.
He fumbled the ball, though, Don, and I don't know who came up with it, but I think Cleveland retained possession.
The ball and the weather are great adversaries as much as the Raiders and Oakland are to each other. A 36-yard punt by Ray Guy and a 5-yard return by Dino Hall. So the Browns will get the ball back when we return. First and 10 at the Oakland side of the field. Four left to play in the first half of this AFC divisional playoff game at cold Cleveland. Tom Flores, there's Oakland Raiders on defense now. First and 10, Cleveland Browns just across midfield. Brian Sipe has been close to some big connections early in this game. One completion to Reggie Rucker in the end zone, but then the official checked his feet and Rucker wasn't in. Here's a throw to Calvin Hill. He can't hold on.
That gives you some indication of how that ball's coming in there. And these receivers, you can't prepare yourself to catch a brick, okay? And that's what that ball has to feel like when it hits their hands.
I'm surprised, John, how well they're running their patterns. Nobody's falling down yet.
That's right. They're running them softly, both offensively and defensively, trying to keep from losing their footing. If they lose their footing, it's a certain interception. A quarterback has to throw the ball when you're on the break. You can't wait till you're open because then you close up. I think that Cleveland's had, this is their fourth good field position. If they get no points on the board when everything's going their way early in the ball game, it could get awfully tough later.
First score is going to be an awful big one. And of course, this game will keep on going until somebody gets a score. Brian Sipe takes a look. Now runs down. Dillon comes up. Sipe. Gunny little guy stays in bounds, gets the extra yardage. He could have bailed out. Joe DeLamalier gave him a block. Brian Sipe took the ball inside the 45-yard line of Oakland. Moving along on little cat's feet here.
Hey, look, Sipe had featured down the field. That's Reggie Rucker down the field. He would love to get to him, but he's very well covered by Lester Hayes. As he rolls out of the pocket looking for a little bit more time, he was looking down the field, had to hold on to the ball. I'm surprised that two quarterback runs he's held on to the ball both times and stayed in bounds. We're getting a penalty.
Ben Bright, the referee. The Raiders were offside, so the Browns beneficiaries of a 5-yard mark off against the Raiders.
Number
first penalty of this game.
Lined up in the neutral zone. Second down.
You'll see strategy change a little here too, because we're normally a third and two situation wouldn't be too bad. They get no traction. Third and two is like third down and five if you're running the ball. It's a passing down today. They've got to find a way to get it over that line.
The two Pruitts are in the Cleveland backfield now. Greg and Mike, no relation. Greg, the Oklahoma runner, has so many great seasons for the Browns as a rusher and as a pass catcher. Slow this year because of injuries, has a knee problem. But he's always a threat.
Second
Greg
five.
Pruitt. Second down and five for Sipe and the Browns. Back to the run. Look at that big back. Whew. Shoot up the middle. Come inside the 40 and down to the 39-yard line. It looks like Mike Pruitt has a first down for Cleveland. John Matuszak and Dave Browning on the knockdown.
Shepard and Deacon just made some room there. On a few occasions where there has been movement at the line of scrimmage, it's been the offensive line of Cleveland that's made it.
Mike Pruitt has been the best runner in this game with 28 yards. The Browns down to the 39-yard line of Oakland with a first down. Rucker is wide right. Logan's on the left flank. Newsom's the tight end, but he can go deep too. Here's a pitch back to Greg Pruitt. And the Raiders get him and throw him down. Hendricks, who's having an all-pro season, came up from the outside linebacker, number 83.
He actually had such a good season that several people put him on the ballot as player of the year. Not defensive player of the year, but Jim Thorpe Trophy player of the year. And he's one of these guys that has put such personality into their defense that it's almost like they're attacking the other team's offense. He's freelanced most of the year. Charlie Sumner's kept everything simple for everybody else. He and Lester Hayes have just made so many turnovers, it's kept everybody off balance.
Ted Hendricks, a four-time All-Pro. Of course, only one defensive player has ever received that Jim Thorpe Trophy. Alan Page, when he's with the Vikings, did, I think, in 72. Second down and 10. Sipe lost the ball.
I think he lost it for good. No, he got to it.
Brian Sipe says, give Sam all the credit. Sam Ratigliano, he's the miracle worker of this team. But Sipe has been a great, great player. Graded out number one among all the quarterbacks.
Don, that's the personality of Brian Sipe. It's also the reason he took an awful lot of knocks earlier in his career. He's not a finger pointer. He's the kind of guy that takes the responsibility, distributes the credit. But he is a very tough nut. He's one of these guys that comes in and takes responsibility for things when things aren't going too well. You noticed he has not backed off from throwing that ball all over the park, and he won't.
It's third down and 10 for the Cleveland Browns at the 40-yard line of Oakland. 8 minutes and 7 seconds to play in the first half.
Careful. Eddie Hendricks.
Eddie Hendricks it was. He came smoking and nobody touched him. So the Browns are taken way out of position.
That's the beautiful thing, Don, when you have a football structure that allows one man to do what he knows it's time to do. He's very familiar with all the offensive structure of Cleveland. When he finds a weakness, he's going to exploit it, and he doesn't have to go to the sideline to do it.
John, Robert L. Jackson of the Browns also has suffered a concussion. He's on the sideline. So two Browns have gone out with head injuries in this game, because even with a helmet on, when you hit the playing field here, you're hitting a rock-hard concrete surface. It was grass. Kick downfield, a good punt. Hops out of bounds at about the 26-yard line. Keith Moody again watched it. Johnny Evans hitting the punt for the Cleveland Browns.
We're changing our viewpoints a little, Don. We're calling those 26-yarders good, and they do look good.
That's right. It was a 24-yard punt. But it's been that kind of a day, and will continue to be when we come back to Cleveland.
When hot.
Tom Flores and Sam Bogosian would rather be in Oakland, but they're glad to be here in the playoffs.
You don't have your druthers when you get here. You just suck it up and go.
First down and 10, Raiders. No score on the board with 7.5 minutes to go. And again, the Raiders go nowhere on the run. Mark Van Egan got the call.
Cleveland's got them playing the game they want them to play. They've got them running the ball on first down. When you do that, Cleveland will stuff you. They haven't been effective throwing the ball. They've only picked up one first down in the entire first half. When you get out 0-0, when you picked up one first down, you're very lucky.
I hope that guy with the hood on doesn't get his number called to go into the game and take him about 5 minutes to get out all that stuff. Plunkett swings it out. Van Egan has the ball. Across the 30, the Browns really come up and strike. Charlie Hall and Bill Cowher on a second down and 8 play make the knockdown at the 31.
You notice when they've thrown the ball off to their backs, they have had a little room to run after they catch it, because when you drop into your secondary drop, you can't get good footing, so you can't get up on Van Egan swiftly. He gets the ball, and he's got a chance to diddle and daddle and make 4, 5, 6, 7 yards. They haven't made many first downs, only one, as we mentioned earlier. But I think if they're going to be effective, they're going to have to start throwing the ball to their backs.
Well, let's see what they go to now. It's third down and 3 for Oakland. No score on the board. 6:23 left to play in the first half. Plunkett takes a look. In the flat, he's intercepted. This will go for a touchdown. The ball is picked off by Ron Bolton. His second interception of the day, and the defense comes up with the first score of this football game. Ron Bolton with his second interception in the flat. They were going to Bob Chandler. Bolton took it, had a clear track into the end zone.
Kind of throw you really want to stay away from. The sideline throw, when you've got a man like Bolton who was just standing back there biding his time. It looked as if Chandler was the man to go to. He did not come out of his pattern well. As a result, it's 6 points for Cleveland. Plunkett goes back to throw the ball. He's trying to look off the secondary. As he comes out, there's no defensive linebacker in the area, but he didn't see Bolton. Bolton was standing waiting the whole time. As soon as that ball was delivered, watch Chandler come out. He kind of comes out and rolls into his pattern. Most of his patterns are crisp. He doesn't see Bolton coming right from behind him, or he'd have been in the way of the ball. Can't get it over for the extra point, though. Still 6-0.
Boy, it's really been affected on the placements. Don Cockcroft with 2 missed field goals and now a missed extra point just didn't get up in the air. The return by Ron Bolton was for 42 yards and the first score of this game. So with 6:10 to go in the first half, the Browns have cut off the schneid.
Very difficult day to run any kind of pattern. You noticed he came out of it and he slid down the line. It enabled Bolton to run right in front of him, pick the ball off the 6.
Let's watch the kickoff now. It's been so difficult to kick the ball. You saw the extra point didn't go anywhere. Cockcroft gets that ball in the air. It is taken down at the 18-yard line. Arthur Whittington turns wide.
A lot of people in front of him.
Ricky Beecher missed him, but slowed him up. And finally, the knockdown is made at about the 36-yard line. So the Raiders go back on offense, 1st and 10. 5:58 to play in the first half. Here's the touchdown again.
Plunk goes back. Sometimes you're trying to take something that you just can't handle. That kind of mistake dictates the outcome of playoff games. As we've looked throughout the league over the first 4 or 5 playoff games, it's been mistakes more than offensive execution that's dictated the outcome.
Sam Rotigliano and Jim Plunkett are old friends. Rotigliano is the offensive coordinator at New England back in 71 when Plunkett came there as the number one pick in the NFL. He says of Plunkett, it's been a career of trauma, but finally he's getting what he deserves and playing with a good team and getting a chance. Plunkett's going to run, throws on the run. Way too much on it. Cliff Branch was downfield, but a Brown, Clay Matthews, ended up nearest it. So did Dick Ambrose come close to getting the ball.
Still trying to go downfield, Don. When you try to go downfield, your quarterback has to wait for his receiver to get open. Cleveland has done very well. They've played it smartly. They're playing a deep zone. They're trying to make Oakland execute inside the seams, and they haven't been able to do it.
We're told from the sideline, John, that it was Ted Hendricks who got a piece of the extra point attempt by Cockrop.
It wasn't going very high. I'm not sure it would have gone in anyway.
Plunkett is 3-for-12 throwing the ball for 21 yards. He's been intercepted twice. Look at Bob Chandler. Did he get
there? There is a reception.
We're talking about Al Davis saying Chandler's a cold weather catcher, and that was a superior play by Bob Chandler.
He can catch a ball in a swimming pool. He's just a great receiver that is really hampered because of the conditions today. Plunkett throws the ball in between the seams. We mentioned he wasn't having much success doing that. Had some success on that occasion, and Chandler made a great catch.
All those seasons in Buffalo helped Bob Chandler. He played 9 years there, a former captain of Southern California. He caught 10 for touchdowns this year for Oakland. Caught 49 balls in a regular season. Swing pass to Kenny King. First down, King turns wide and gets down to the 45-yard line of the Cleveland Browns. Clay Matthews ran him out of bounds.
I know that Oakland doesn't like to take those little dink-off patterns because it just isn't in the way they like to run the ball up and down the field. They like to go down the field and challenge the defense. But today, they're going to find a few linebackers falling down, and they're going to pick up some long yards if they'll continue to do it. You'll notice every time they've come off, they've completed the ball, and they picked up 4, 5, 6, or 7. There's no need to try anything else until they're stopped.
Well, that's probably what Plunkett then will continue to do. Get the underneath short pass. The Browns gave up a lot of yards to that this season. They take away the long pass. Plunkett stands in, has time, throws the ball, and it's caught for a first down. Again, they go underneath the zone coverage down to the 39-yard line.
Hit your backs, baby. I think he's got a first down, but they may rule it a foot short.
See where they spot the ball down. Could be short. Raiders thought they had it. Their sideline is protesting. Mark Van Egan, the receiver, ball down just inside the 40. So it's going to be third down and less than a yard. Game clock, 5 minutes to play in the first half. Cleveland Browns lead 6-0 on a 42-yard interception return by Ron Bolton, who's intercepted two today for Cleveland.
Now it's up to their offensive linemen. They haven't been able to get much surge so far in the ball game. They've got to get them a foot.
You look through these stands, it appears the no-shows are non-existent. Everybody's here. Over 80,000.
Good play by Jim Plunkett. Picks up in the backfield. His running backs never did get a clean slate at the ball. He took it, jumped over the center for a first down. That's their third one of the ball game, second on this drive.
It's tough.
Look, you can see, just couldn't get a clean handoff. Found a hole and took it.
Jim Plunkett dives for the first down, down to the 38-yard line of Cleveland.
Van Egan could not get his footing. Was into the hole late.
Wind chill just before game time measured at minus 37 degrees here at Cleveland. Minus 37.
Draw play.
Kenny King running hard takes the ball down to the 31-yard line. Plunkett and the Raiders starting to move now. Jim Plunkett's had his problems with two interceptions. You'll recall he also fumbled the ball.
This is not the kind of day where you challenge defenses. You take what they give you and you make them react to what you've taken. They've done that on this drive and they've been effective. You remember they've hit two backs. Chandler makes a great catch, and now Kenny King gets a little room to run a draw.
You think the offense has an advantage on the slippery field?
Sometimes. Not so far today.
Down to the 29-yard line of second down and 3. Lyle Alzado made the play, so did Clay Matthews. Alzado's been a great leader, number 77 of these Cleveland Browns. He came in here, of course, from Denver. He's known Sam Rotigliano for a long time. They're both from Brooklyn. Said Rotigliano said to him, Lyle, you know I love you. Just give me whatever you have left.
You know what he's brought? He's brought the composure of a guy who's been in a championship game. His whole personality is geared toward getting all of it, folks. You know, let's not just get a piece, let's get it all. We're as good as anybody else. And I think that's brought a lot of the younger players up to the level they're playing today.
just over a yard now for the Oakland Raiders. Back to the run, and now the Raiders start to crack it. Trap blocking up the middle of the fullback, Van Egan, takes it down to the 25-yard line.
And this has been a beautiful drive. They were totally inept in the first quarter and a half. They got the ball with 5.5 minutes to play. In 3 minutes, they've run off 3 first downs. They've done things a whole lot more creatively, and they haven't tried to pick on them down the field. They're taking what they've been given.
Sam Ratigliano went to the same high school in Brooklyn as Al Davis, the man who runs the Raiders did, Erasmus Hall. He said, Sam says, Al was a little bit ahead of me in a lot of ways.
I'm not sure of that.
First down and 10 now for Oakland. They trail 6-0. Plunkett stands in, throws, it comes up on the one hop. Linton Burrell was the closest to it. And the game clock is stopped with 1:57 left to play in the first half.
They have doubled Cliff Branch all day long. That's why they have not been able to get to him. Unless they change, they won't be able to.
1:57 left to play in the first half with the Raiders with the ball trailing 6-0. The preceding announcement was furnished by the National Football League. Don Crickey with John Brody. Mike Adamley also here with us at Cleveland Stadium. 1:57 left to play in this AFC divisional playoff game, left to play in the first half. Coming up at halftime, we'll be going to New York to Bryant Gumbel. An update on the playoff activity as it's been so far. San Diego Chargers a victor yesterday. And they'll be the host team next week for the AFC Championship game on NBC next Sunday. The winner of this game goes to San Diego. It's second down and 10. Handoff. King bounces off, tries to run wide, and the Browns turn it in. Clay Matthews finally caught him and knocked him down. A former number one draft choice of the Browns out of Southern California. Third-year linebacker. Browns have good linebacking. So do the Raiders.
And boy, they've got everything going for him today, Don, because when a man breaks a tackle at the point of attack and he starts going laterally, any sort of pursuit is going to catch him because he can't turn up. He can't get any strength going forward for himself. He can't get his shoulders going forward. He can't get his foot in any kind of placement to take on a linebacker. He's at the total mercy of the linebacker.
And now it's third down and 13 for Oakland. Branch and Chandler are both wide right. Here's Kenny King coming in motion to the near side. Plunkett stands in. They're giving him more time now. Raymond's caught. Raymond Chester down to the 2-yard line. So the Oakland Raiders are now point blank range. First and goal from the 2.
Don, that was an absolutely perfect throw by Plunkett. He was in a situation where he had Kenny King in motion out to the other side. 3 men on 1 against Chester. He put the ball where it had to be thrown at a perfect time. Chester cradled it with his body. Comes down with a first down inside the 5. This drive has been vintage. They're doing things that they're not accustomed to doing. That's the first time that they've run a play that's within keeping of their personality. It was effective, great execution.
That was their biggest play of this game, a 26-yard gain on the throw from Plunkett to Raymond Chester down to the 2-yard line. Spotted just outside the 2. The best in college basketball returns Saturday.
Don, we've got 1:03 remaining in the half. The Raiders still have a couple timeouts. There really is no problem. They can take all 4 downs to score it. That ball being just inside the 3 is a little misleading. They may not be able to get that thing in there at running the ball from the line of scrimmage.
So now the Browns leading 6-0 back to their end zone. The Raiders come out with one of the biggest, toughest forward walls in football. Lining up to power the ball at Cleveland and try to tie the game.
He slipped when they were trying to hand the ball off to him. It's absolutely frozen solid down there inside the 5-yard line. He couldn't get a grab on the ball when he got it because he came out having slipped to start off. You see, he got a late start, never gets the ball in his grasp. When he does, it bounces right up to him.
That is really a tough area of the field, John. That's right. That's ice down there.
To fumble the ball 1.5 yards forward, pick and recover it yourself, that's a gift, folks. It's bouncing just right.
Plunkett has a problem, throws it away in the end zone. Derek Ramsey was somewhere near the ball, but a blitz was coming.
It's a good play by Clarence Scott, Don.
Don Goody coming on the blitz, number 50. Yeah, Clarence Scott had the coverage on it.
Well, it was a little delayed pattern, and actually Derek Ramsey would have been wide open. Plunkett could have taken something off the ball and had him run right under it. Scott was alert.
Over the years, the Raiders have pretty much dominated the Browns in seven previous meetings. The Raiders have won six, including one last year at Oakland in the regular season. Oakland beat Cleveland 19-14. Next Sunday, January 11th, the San Diego Chargers meet the winner of today's game for the AFC Championship. The victor defending the AFC's honor in the Super Bowl, where seven of the last nine champions have been American Conference teams. NBC's coverage of the American Conference Championship game next Sunday begins at 4:30 with NFL 80. Join host Brian Gumble for an inside look at the AFC Championship game. And then watch the best of the AFC battle for a trip to Super Bowl 15 coming up January 25th on NBC.
Don, anybody getting an opportunity to get out of this ball game with a victory and avoiding frostbite would look awful forward to going out into that 70-degree temperature.
I tell you, these fans are playing hurt, too. That's going to be tough in there.
Tell you, there aren't many empty seats, though.
Virtually none. Over 80,000. Cleveland Browns, Cleveland Stadium. What a history this place has. Great, great teams over the years. Place has rocked to the cheers of 80,000 Cleveland fans so many Sundays.
Third down and two, I'm sure. Oakland has discussed whether to go for two plays or one.
Van Egan takes it into the end zone. Touchdown, Oakland Raiders, and the football game is tied with 18 seconds to play in the first half.
Great movement, Don, by Mickey Marvin and Henry Lawrence. Those two guys moved the defense of the Browns a yard, yard and a half back. And that's the only way you're going to gain any yardage today. Get your offensive linemen to do their job, because nobody can bowl anybody over. Excellent play. Number 70, number 65. Get the defenders on the ground, allow the back to go over the top.
So now Chris Barr comes out. He had an excellent playoff game against Houston. Chris Barr, 3 for 3 in extra points, 2 for 2 in field goals in his first playoff game ever last week.
I think it'll be a little easier for a sideline to get the ball up in this weather. We'll see. Might break his foot, but I think he can get it up.
Bob Chandler holds. The extra point is up and right down the middle. So Chris Barr delivers, and it is now an Oakland Raider lead, 7-6, with 18 seconds left to play in the first half.
Don, give credit to Jim Plunkett. That was a beautifully conceived drive. He did things in very difficult conditions, threw the ball where it had to be thrown. Chandler came down with one great catch, but he put the ball around the infield, threw it to the areas that were open. As a result, put on about a 65-yard drive, and they got a touchdown right after an interception. That's the change in Jim Plunkett. You know, earlier he used to get his dauber down a little bit, wouldn't come right back. Winning 10 out of 12 games that he's played in the latter part of the season this year, I think, has really given him a lot of confidence, and the Raiders have a lot in him.
They do. He came in as a free agent, 78. 64-yard drive, and watch Bob Chandler, one of the great holders in football, set it down gingerly, and Barr bangs it.
That comes into play today,
doesn't it? The Raiders break the tie, a 64-yard drive, 14 plays, Van Egan on the payoff end from a yard out. And the extra point by Chris Barr gives the Oakland Raiders a 7-6 lead with 18 seconds to play in the first half. Now, Charles White, the Heisman Trophy winner a year ago from Southern California, the number one draft choice of the Browns, is in to return the kickoff along with Dino Hall. Hall gets the ball. Across the 20, right up the gut. He comes out to the 35-yard line on the fly. 14 seconds left to play in the half. Steve Sylvester was on the stop for the Raiders.
Be very surprised, Don, if Oakland plays that man-to-man defense they've been playing throughout the first half now. They've got to put people back, take away the opportunity for a long gainer or a penalty, because you can bet Brian's going to heave it up there.
Brian will be a pitch, and he comes out now. He'll be going home to San Diego next week to play the Chargers if the Browns advance to that game.
Win or lose, I got to believe he'll be out there.
Played at San Diego State, Ryan Seif. Computers aren't always right. He wasn't drafted until the 12th round. Ryan Seif on first down, stands in, throws long. Rucker gets the ball and is out of bounds at the 48-yard line. 8 seconds left.
One more pitch. They've got to get it down to the 25-yard line, Don. They've got to get about 23 yards on this next play within 8 seconds. They've still got a timeout left. That would give Cockcroft a chance to change his luck a little bit. But anything over 40 yards, I relate to as utterly impossible.
It has been for Cockcroft. He's really had his problems. hit it. Sidewinder, no problem on the extra point. 7-6, Oakland leads. 6 seconds left in the half. As Sipe throws long. Logan's going for the ball. Lester Hayes intercepted another one. The man is absolutely phenomenal. 17 interceptions he has this season. 4 in the playoffs. Lester Hayes of Texas A&M.
He's playing the only way he should play at this time. He was playing 25 yards deep. They figure if we're going to have a go at it, let's try him again. See if he can come down with this one.
Well, I know what I'd do with him, John. I'd put him on offense, too. Lester would be going both ways for me today because he can catch it better than anybody out there.
He does pretty well just going the way he does. Here goes Logan down the field. You know he's not going to get behind Hayes. A lot of fellas be content just to bat it down, not Lester. Put another skin on the wall.
So the Raiders rally back and take the lead. That's the end of the first half. With the score, the Oakland Raiders 7, the Cleveland Browns 6.